makes you happy is good about being at POTS. When I started thinking about coming with you to share, the one word that kept popping up was community. When Tim and Ned got together from the Saturday nights in Covenant House, they began to see the same young men coming back over and over again. And what seemed to be the recurring theme was these young men needed a stable place. They needed a community. And so, in a way, that was underpinning whatever we were going to do. I was finishing a job, and I went to Ned and said I would like to do something to have direct service with people who were living on the margins, the poor. And he said, well, why don't you go find this job? And you could do this, you could do that, you could do the other thing. Well, I kept coming back. And my community was willing to pay my stipend so that we didn't have to worry about a salary for me. So I met with Tim and Ned, and we began to talk about what way I could help, and then what the young men were saying about needing a place to be stable, and that they said, there are people who are worse off than we are, and they need food. And so it was from their idea and their statement that the possibility of a soup kitchen would begin. Tim, Ned, Marty Colavito, and Alan Wood, great friends of ours, went to the Jersey Shore and began to talk about possibilities.
You'll jump in.
And so the whole idea began to really materialize. Ned had an apartment on Valentine Avenue, not far from here, where young men could come, and good old Casey, the big German Shepherd, who was a big part of our lives, because you know, dogs and animals always seem to know when somebody's hurting and reach out to them. So there was a house on Bedford Park Boulevard that was purchased, and that became the center, the community for the young men from the streets. But Tim and I were given the marvelous job of trying to find a building for the soup kitchen. And we spent a lot of time going from place to place looking for possibilities. We went to the office of Mario Biaggi, who was the assemblyman at that time, and he said, I have a perfect place for you. It's an abandoned school. It's big. It will really work for all the things you want to do. So Tim and I get very excited, and we go to the area and the address, and guess what? The building was raised about 3 or 4 years ago, so no possibility there.
Big empty lot.
It was big and empty. And then the parish of St. Nicholas of Tolentine knew about what we wanted to do, and the pastor there said, I know of a storefront on Fordham Road that you might want to look at. The rent was reasonable. Tim and I go look at it, and we see the possibilities. And so we say to Ned, we found the place. We see the possibilities. Ned comes and says, are you too crazy? This is a dump. This will never, never work. And we said, we'll give it a shot for our first place. You cannot imagine how many people helped us. People gave us a sink, a refrigerator. Somebody else gave us the tiles for the floor and table and chairs. So that the whole beginning of the soup kitchen took place on the goodness of other people. The first check that we got came from Sister Ann Montgomery's family trust. Money was not big. Everything was little bits that came in to us. It was very, very important that the community of POTS was what made us grow. We were starting to look at when we would begin and what we would do. We did have a small Christmas meal and a few things before we opened so that people would, the word would get out.
Well, Thanksgiving and Christmas.
Thanksgiving and Christmas. And then we were going to open on January 6, 1982. The Feast of the Epiphany. All the wise ones coming. And then, well, Ned's sister, Margaret Murphy, who was a sister of charity, decided she would help us. So she made a big pot of pea soup and brought it up on the train. Well, guess what? More pea soup on Margaret than came to the soup kitchen. And then there was Olga, a lady who lived around the corner, and we had put posters up all over. She said, you can't do that. You have got to go and meet people and tell people what you're doing. And so that was the next step for us. The first day, one person came, Alan. And then from then on in, people just kept coming and coming. We had nothing. Tim would go at night to Hot and Crusty and pick up the old bread, the day old bread. Schools that had milk left over, we picked up the containers of milk. Vegetables came from the Hunts Point Market and many other places.
We got bones.
Can
I just grab it?
Sure.
So I was just, I went back in the kitchen to say hello to Diz before, and I see piles of chicken back there, chicken being prepared. Some of it's, you know, already been cooked, some of it's sitting in the sink. Just piles of these meaty pieces of chicken. And I remember what we used to get was, we would get, you know, we'd go to the butchers and we would get bones, and all the meat was pretty much off the bones. You might get a little bit. And we'd boil those suckers for hours and hours.
Rolling
hours,
boil.
To try to get some kind of a broth. And basically people, when they came, their nourishment was that broth. Hopefully we'd throw some pasta in if we had it.
Right.
We'd get some vegetables from different places in the Hunts Point Market, stuff that was, they couldn't sell anymore, and we'd chop that up and stick it in there. And so it's just the contrast of seeing all those big, nice pieces of chicken with what we dealt with at the time was, to me, it was a lovely thing to see. I mean, I'll give it back to you
no,
just a second,
right,
but
no.
Just reminded me of this. So, and at that time, when we first started, Jane said, you know, one guy came in the door. But word started to spread, and pretty soon there would be 25, 30, 40, 50. And you know, we didn't know. I think you guys have a good handle on what time of the month you're going to be getting how many people in, and you probably have a lot of stats and numbers, I imagine, that gives you some idea. But we didn't really know from day to day if we would have 50 people coming in or 75 people coming in. So you boil those bones, and you stick in some vegetables, and you got your bread. And then you watch as the day goes on, and more people are coming in, and your pot is here and starting to go down. And so, you know, you didn't have much of a choice. You had a choice of no soup or watered down soup. So you start boiling a teapot full of water, and you pour the boiling water into the soup pot to keep the soup at a level at which you can serve it. And I remember feeling terrible about doing that. Like, I knew that the people that came in first got a nice tasty broth, because you boil bones long enough, you get a nice broth. And the people that came at the end of the day got this watered down, you know. But they were happy with it, you know, and it was either no soup or watered down soup. And I remember at the time when I struggled with that, there's a friend of ours who was a part of our original board, a guy named Father Dan Berrigan, and Jack knew Dan very well, much better than I did. But there was one thing that he said at the time that helped me that sounds a little bit, like in today's world, it sounds like a terrible thing to say, but at the time it was really helpful. And what he said was, anything worth doing is worth doing poorly. He had a way of turning a phrase. He was the guy that, when he burned draft records in Catonsville, said, don't just do something, stand there. So he would turn phrases around like that. But that phrase, you know, anything worth doing is worth doing poorly, to me was really helpful at the time, because we didn't have the resources to do things well. You could see what needed to be done, but you only had so much. And so those days were And, you know, we're a matter of just making do with what little that we had.
And Ned would give me $20 to go to Pathmark across the bridge. And that was how much money we had every day, besides the donations that we got. And hopefully, we got people to give us cans of broth or soup, so that helped us a little bit.
We poured the water. Sometimes we had a can of broth.
Soup that we could put in it. I'd like to tell you a story about a lady named Annie and the bones. Every time Annie had a child, she went into postpartum depression. Her family had money, but she lived down in Washington Square Park. No, excuse me, Washington Heights Park. And one day she came and asked if she could get washed. I said to her, Annie, we don't have a shower. There's no way that you can take a shower. She said, I just need to get washed. So I said, all right, come back after the soup kitchen is closed. And she did. And her feet were so black and so cracked with dirt in them. It took a little bit of bleach to wash her feet. And as a result of that, she came back every morning before the soup kitchen opened and took some of those bones. I have never in my entire life seen anybody find meat that she could get off that bone and clean it with a knife. And she was just grateful for the company. And it's true, we learned as we went along. We really did. Always it was important that the people who came were our guests. Respect, looking people in the eye, and reflecting. One of the things that we were big about in the early days was reflecting on the experience and also connecting what was happening in the economic and cultural environment with why people were kept poor. And in many ways, it was that propelled us into the kinds of actions that we took as we moved forward. So it was a combination of being with the people, providing services, food really, in the earliest days, and making the connection between what was happening in society and what was happening that had an impact on the poor. And that was the beginning of our days of resistance.
Chris has asked me to mention this again. I have a hard time repeating myself, but Chris says you have to say a thing seven times for people to get it. And I think that the values inherent in this story are really what brought POTS together. So I first met Ned in 1979, and I had come from Indiana. I don't want to go into the whole story, but what brought me to New York was a sense of wondering whether or not the things I read in the gospel were true. You know, and you know, you go to those of you who have been to suburban churches and grown up in them, you hear a lot of things on the pulpit and you don't see a lot of those things. And when you're a young kid who's 17 or 18, you think everybody is a hypocrite. You know, you guys probably know people like that. My son is one of them. You know, what I saw at the time was, you know, gospel being preached in my church and in my neighborhood and people that I knew at my schools that I didn't see being lived out. And those gospel values really were service to the poor. They were understanding that the least among us, that is what we do for the least among us, that's what we're doing for Jesus or for our Lord. That sense of a disconnect between what I saw, read in the Gospels and what I saw around me drove me to say, either this is really important or it's BS. And so I hopped on a bus and I came to New York and I ended up at this place called Covenant House in Times Square. And they had and I showed up on their door and said, you know, I've come to help. And you had to be at least 22 at that time, and I was 18. But they let me stay for a month to assess whether or not I was crazy and whether or not they could let me into the community. And they let me in. And there was a Franciscan type community, where you're a Catholic Franciscan type community, where you you worked at the Covenant House, which was a crisis center for homeless young people in Times Square, and you pray three times a day. You had the morning prayer and the evening prayer and night prayer. And I had a real problem with the morning prayer, so people didn't like to get up early. I was young, so I was 18, and you had to be like 22 to be a part of this thing, because the people who were being served were 21 and under. So I wasn't allowed to work in the center with the youngsters. So I kept saying, please let me do something. So finally, listen, you can do the overnight shift with this priest, Father Ned. You can do that with him. That's all you can do. You got to be with him, you know, supervised by him, and you can do that once a week. The rest of the week I worked in the offices doing very important administrative kinds of work, but not the kind of work that when you're that age you feel is satisfying, because you understand the importance of those things. So I worked with Ned, and that's how I began to know Ned. And Ned was the first person in my young eyes that I experienced who I didn't think was a hypocrite. So Ned was a person who put these values into action. So the young people that he saw at Covenant House, he did what he could to be helpful to them. So when they came to him with needs that Covenant House couldn't meet, you know, and really needs for a community, he started taking people into his apartment. And as you know, Jane mentioned, you know, that apartment in the Bronx started to like crowd up with a lot of these youngsters that just didn't have any family. So the whole idea of community came from that. And my sense of, okay, now I see someone here who's actually putting this into practice was really important to me. At that time, however, I learned that I really wasn't terribly interested in working with young people so much. They can be a pain. But from the minute I stepped off the bus in Manhattan, this was 1979, and it's better now, but back then there were just homeless people all over the streets, and there was a culture shock for me. I'm walking into Manhattan, I'm stepping over people on the sidewalks, and I'm watching hundreds of other people stepping over people on the sidewalk. And where I came from, you would stop and say, "Are you okay?" You know, this was a very different culture for me. And did I stop and say, "Are you okay?" No, I stepped over people like everyone else, but I just felt a pang in my heart every time I did it. So I was more interested in working with older adults, homeless folks. And so when Ned and I and Marty and Alan started talking about this, that was the idea. He would have this house, and we would also, you know, do something that reached out to the larger homeless community. And that's kind of how POTS started. And those values of being service to the poor, of seeing God in the least of them, those are the values that brought everyone together there. They were the values that brought the people from Rye, in New York, from a parish, Resurrection Parish up there. That's what brought them to POTS. It's what brought the Fordham students like Jack to POTS. So Jack, was it 1982 when you first came to volunteer at POTS?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, so we started in January 82, and you probably would have come maybe a couple months later, right? At the most.
September, October.
Yeah,
okay.
So
you were like the fall of it. Okay. But, you know, those were the things, that the Fordham student connection, you know, what drew them and what drew people from Resurrection Parish. That's where some of our resources started to come in. But it was those values that brought everyone together. And again, our idea was to start to be a community. And so that's what we did. We were just people wanting to be of service and be in community with people in need, which is what I love about, you know, I can't take credit for this wonderful mission statement class has. Because ours was a nice mission statement. We wrote it when Jane mentioned we were on the Jersey Shore back in 1980. We wrote a nice mission statement. It was long. and it had like everything that Ned thought his whole life was in that mission statement.
It's true. It is very, very true.
But this mission statement, POTS' mission is to be a loving community in the Bronx that nourishes the basic needs and hungers of all who come to this door, summarizes, capitalizes what we were about at the time. And being a community is different than being a professional. And so it was, some of our challenges were that people came with needs, and needs that weren't being met by the professional communities that they would come involved in. And then they would bring those needs to us and we would try to figure out what the heck to do with them. So, you know, issues that hopefully in this organization you talk about and struggle with, issues of boundaries and so forth, we didn't talk about those things. That we just tried to do whatever we could do. And that creates problems with sustainability. So, you know, one of my favorite guys, that one of the first ones that came, was a guy named Douglas. And Jack smiles, you say the guy's name, and if you know him, a person smiles. He was just a wonderful, wonderful man. But he, when he first came in, he had this face that he could look really mean and nasty. So when he first came in, that's all you saw. You saw this, you know, very suspicious guy. He was hungry. He would eat. He would look around. He suspected, like, why are you doing this? You know, why are you doing these nice things? And for probably a few weeks, he would come in every day and just give us that look. You know, eat his food and give us that kind of eye, that suspicious eye. And one day, he has a seizure in the middle of the soup kitchen. And as Jane mentioned, this was a really tiny soup. This was a Pullman car, basically, with a loft. That's how big this place was. We could seat like 16 people all squint together, and then they would turn over to get, you know, 100 people or so, 150 people in a couple hours. And it was like, it had to be a pretty quick turnover. Anyway, in the middle of this little tiny soup kitchen, Douglas has a seizure. And so the ambulance comes and picks him up and, you know, take him to the hospital, and I leave and go with him to the hospital, to the ER. And, you know, he's fine after a few hours. And the reason he had a seizure is because he's gotten beat up pretty badly years before and had a traumatic brain injury, had a plate in his head, and so he occasionally would get these seizures. But in the hospital, you know, after he's waking there, and they're talking to me a little bit because I was with him, and they ask him for the name and contact information of a significant other. Or someone, family, friend, someone. And Douglas had nobody to give. He had a mom who I think was in a nursing home who he would talk about and love very much, but who wasn't able to be too much of a part of his life. And that was one of the moments for me that made me kind of realize what these folks really needed in terms of community, is that he had no one to put down. So I'm a guy that serves them soup for the past few weeks, and I become his emergency contact, his significant other. And I think that is, for me, that was how I understood this community needed to evolve. So we had people coming to us for food, but they had so many other needs. And we were limited in terms of how we could meet those needs, but we did our best. And if you look at all the things that you're doing now, are outgrowths of that, of us, of all of us, seeing the limitations of what we could provide and trying to add on more services. You trying to say something, Jane?
I might. Tim said to me last night, don't worry, I'll talk forever. but the important thing is what you say in terms of where we are. I think when you look at what Tim was saying in terms of the years since 1982, there has been a consistent movement from the days when we were so little and it was three people. Then we had the volunteers and the growth, but it was three, a very small circle. And you look at you now. But the reality is the continuity and the seeing of the needs. I think I was saying to Tim before, the whole idea of feeding hungers. Yes, people come in for soup and to pantry and clothes, but it's the paying attention to the hungers of people's hearts that really makes a difference in their lives. And no matter whether it was 1982 or today, that's the important thing about POTS. We can tell you stories about wonderful people. John, who used to take people to Graymore.
It was like a rehab facility.
For alcoholism. You know, it was wonderful people. And the whole idea of Ned, no haves and have-nots. There were times, I remember one day when I was the only one there. No volunteers. Whatever happened, Tim and Ned were doing something for us outside. None of the volunteers came that day. The guests stood up, and they were the ones who took care of the serving and the doing the dishes and making sure that the bread got on the table and things were cleaned up. That said volumes to me in terms of our being a community together. And
I think Jack was signed up that day.
He pulled the whole thing. He didn't want to come. But, the time that I was there was its absolute beginnings. And the different people who came taught us the lessons that we needed to know. There was one gentleman who came every day in a business suit and a clean white shirt and an attaché case. And one day I went up to him and I said, "Why are you here? What is it that we can do for you?" And he said, "Every day I go someplace to take a shower. And I need that for my own dignity." He had been on the street for about 2 or 3 years. He had nothing, no place to live, nothing. But what was important to him as he moved forward. Continuity, community, the values that were important to us as we began, I think are important to you. It's the heart of what you're at. For Sisters of Charity, one of our founders, Vincent DePaul, called us the servants of the poor. And that where we were, we would find where God was as long as we were with the poor. So being with the poor teaches us many things in terms of what's in our hearts and what they can say about life. I guess the other thing I want to say is what you're doing in immigration today and the culture that is before us is at the edge of what we need. No haves, no have-nots, inclusiveness. And then if you look at every other department that you have and you get underneath the meaning of why you do this, I think you're going to find the same thing. Why and how can you make a difference in people's lives to make a difference in society and in the culture that is prevalent among us today?
I was going to say something similar to Jane about the immigration thing. So just in terms of that value, that whatsoever you do to the least among us, and least is not a pejorative, you know, in the way I think of it, it means the least powerful, the person that has the least ability to influence their environment and their place in it. That is what brought us all together. And when you think of who is the least powerful, you know, you think of immigrants who are undocumented, who don't have the protections of citizenship or even, you know, legal standing. And so when I see that this work is being done here, it really makes me feel wonderful. And you guys are staying with that, with those values. So I thank you all for that. And I think this is a good wrap for questions, Chris.
Yeah, I mean, this is an inspiring message. I mean, I think everyone here at POTS today has sort of a corollary with their experience, because I think it really runs true from when your time to this time, but I think it's incredible to hear it. I'll just speak for me. This is one of those things that recharges my battery all the way up to the top, and it's incredible to hear. But I think it'd be great to offer up some questions for the next couple of minutes, see if anyone wants to just sort of ask you any range of topics, whether it's stories, whether it's you know, how you've seen the evolution, anything.
I have a question. How did the whole building next door start? Like,
that's a great. That's a really good question. Unfortunately, I could go on for a long time. Try not to. So. The little old storefront on 270 East Fordham Road, there was a, we paid, I think you looked at it, we started out like paying $275 a month for that. I think we ended up with $350 is what it says right there.
$350
a month, right?
No, he was asked, well, all right, go ahead.
what's that?
No, keep going. We do this all the time. Yeah. I mean, you just have to know this is
so,
the...
So a new owner bought, it was a part of a large building that had apartments above it and storefronts along the street. And a new owner bought it, and you know, I think he had ideas of maybe doing some gentrification in that area. And so he wanted the soup kitchen out of there, you know, because we would have lines of people lined up, and it wasn't the kind of thing that was great for business, maybe. And so he raised our rent like to $3,000 a month, you know, from the $300 a month. So he raised our rate. So we keep paying him the $350 a month, and we say, listen, you can evict us. And you know, we got some friends over to I'm not sure what the news channel was, you know, but we'll have the news come out, and you can evict us from the soup kitchen right in front of the news cameras. So that actually worked for a little while. But this was New York back in 1985, 86. So, you know, I'm sure things are different now. But back then, there was a little bit of corruption, I think, that happened. So this fellow, you know, apparently he got someone in the building department to come in and condemn just this little section of this big building. They came in and found that this little storefront was not structurally sound. So we got evicted by the building department. So that was 1986, yeah. So, you know, at that point, we had nothing. And that was when we realized that we needed to go from just, we needed to own our own building. We couldn't have this happen to us again. We couldn't, you know, allow our services to be so dependent upon someone else. So, and that's when we went from being a loving community to an organization that whose mission it was to be a loving community. So we got incorporated at that point in 1986, and that was a bit of a controversy. So we were all pretty, you know, Jack would know, we were kind of like, you know, radical folks, you know. So we and our people on our board and Ned and they were kind of radical folks, and they didn't believe in doing things like incorporating, because as Dorothy Day said, you know, everything is the fault of this stinking rotten system, and being even incorporated would be a part of that system. So no one wanted to do that. They felt that was somehow corrupting ourselves to a certain extent. So, you know, but I realized that there's no way we're going to be able to raise money, get foundation money, get this building, do all the things we need to do without being incorporated. So a friend of mine, Greg Loken, I said to Greg, let's just go down and incorporate the place. And so we did incorporate. And once I came back with the incorporation papers, nobody had a problem. Everybody was happy. You know, it was just like no one wanted to get their hands dirty and do that thing. But that was the beginning of POTS being an organization with a mission of being a loving community. And that's when we were able to, that's when accountability started. All these things that Chris and Christine, everybody deals with every day to make certain that POTS is able to stay afloat and stay growing in services. So Ned, once we got that, Ned went to Resurrection Parish on one Sunday and preached at Resurrection Parish in Rye, and we raised like $65,000. Now, we had actually, you know, went down and we put our offer down. We had offered on the building with a close date that was like 2 weeks after that preaching at Rye, and we had no money to close, you know, to put down at closing. We just thought, well, hopefully we'll raise a lot of it there. We had like 10 grand that we raised before that to put down and so forth. And Ned raised that money at Resurrection, and we had that cash, and we came back 2 weeks later and we closed on the building at 2763.
You know, we never had anything, but somehow when the need arose, everybody rose to the point of how can we get the money that we need, but you couldn't keep going forward like that. You know, when you look at what you need and the grants that you need and the work that you've done in with Robin Hood, so it is how to put the two things together to organize, to get the things that you need and never lose the values that are at the heart of what POTS is all about.
I don't have a question. I just want to say thank you. You both are an inspiration, and it's an honor to carry the torch for what you started. You really moved me today. I feel like starting a march or something. But thank you, though, sincere.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Tim said we were radicals, and we were in our day, and I hope in our own way now we are still radicals.
Jack still is.
I think it's important that if you are going to continue to raise the level of vision for people to see, that it's a person who's sick, it's a person who needs health care, it's a person who needs a place to live. You have to figure out how you can be radical at this particular point in time.
Any other questions? I'm sure there's some.
Tim, can you talk about, I'm thinking of the roots of a lot of the programs we have today, for example, medical care on site. Can you talk about some of the stuff you did up in that loft on Fordham Road?
Oh, yeah.
With your training?
Yeah, or without it. One of my first friends, Jane, has a similar story, but, you know, people would come in with medical needs, and they would present themselves to us, and again, you know, anything worth doing is worth doing poorly. You do your best. And one of my favorite experiences was this woman that they used to call them bag ladies at the time. I'm not sure if that phrase is still out there, if it's considered derogatory, but, you know, a homeless woman with a lot of plastic bags that they would carry around. And she had this big dressing on her lower leg, on her calf, and it was dirty, and you could tell that the thing needed to be changed, you know, and she would come in and started to smell. It smelled really bad, you know, and so the other people in the soup kitchen would complain, we can't eat with this woman in here because this thing smells so bad. And so, you know, it took a while, but finally I was okay. One day I asked her to come in a little bit later, and we fed her, and said, let me just take a look at this thing. And, you know, this was, you know, the bandage around her leg was all brown and black and crusty and all, but when I undid the bandage, underneath it was the swarm of maggots. And you know, maggots are kind of hard to pick off, you know. So, yeah, you call people and you ask, how do you get maggots off of there? So we, you know, you picked each maggot off. And the beautiful thing about it was, however, once you got every maggot out of there, you had the cleanest wound you'd ever seen in your life, because the maggots think they eat all the dead tissue, and it's really nice. But, you know, once I got it cleaned out, you know, I didn't know what the heck to do with it, you know. And so you try to send her to the, you know, at that point you didn't have urgent care centers, you didn't have these, you know, send her back to the ER, and they don't really take good care of people there. So you do your best with what you have, but those kinds of experiences are what led us to, you know, very shortly after we got into 2763, was to say we need to have medical services for our folks that come in here. So we worked with folks, it was Montefiore. There was a healthcare for the homeless program, so we started having them come in once a week, and that was kind of how the healthcare services started. Was that what you were thinking of, Jack, in terms of your story? I think that you may have had a similar experience.
Yes, but as a result of all this, Tim became a nurse.
Yeah, well, it was also getting a scholarship to nursing school, which I do have to credit Jane with helping me to get, yes.
But, you know, every time we didn't organize needs. You have to understand this. But every time something presented itself, whether it was healthcare or clothing needs or food needs, we found ways to take care of it in a very simple way. We had a terrible loft, which we had, whenever clothing donations came in and we tried to sort them, right, Jack? And sometimes it was, you had a lot, sometimes you didn't have little. Sometimes Hunts Point came with a lot of vegetables, fresh vegetables, so you could use so much for soup of a day. So we started giving out food. And so in our own simple way, we took care of the needs that we were faced with. And I think you do that in your own way too. Every need that presents itself, you kind of take a look in the eye and say, what can we do here? You know, so that That's a continuous piece, again, from the early days to now.
Even the immigration services, I think I remember Carlos Jack, who you worked with in the very beginning. So it just started out, you know, and again back then, you know, Jack took, his work with Carlos became very, you know, above any kind of boundary that you would normally. I mean, Jack just got involved in Carlos's life, and he didn't have papers, and he had a lot of issues, and so. It is sometimes those people that come in with needs that you try your best to meet and you aren't able to do that lead you to develop programs so that you can do a better job of taking care of those folks.
I mean, I think one thing I'd like to ask is with regards to the name of part of the solution, just the idea of, so let's say with someone that you weren't able to help, what were some of the lessons you learned in terms of what the limits were? Just from a sort of a personal, how do you navigate when you're trying your hardest to help somebody and there's, you know, it doesn't always work?
Well, I think in some ways, an example of that was when Montefiore came in. You know, how do you network? How do you, if we can't do it, to find the resources that we couldn't take people to Graymore to the AA recovery program. But John did it. But we had to go search. Where were the places where we could refer people to? And it really is important to network.
Yeah, and on a larger basis as well, you know, doing what you're doing and taking care of people's needs and forming community with people is a part of the solution. There are other parts, and one of those things are, you know, why is it that we have all these people? Why is there such income inequality? Why do we have all these? That's a bigger, addressing those things are a bigger part of the solution. And so the name part of the solution was, in a sense, a recognition with humility that these are important things that really can help people, but it is only a part of the solution. There are bigger parts that need to be addressed in order to prevent people from having these needs to begin with, and just even the legal services. So, you know, taking care of people that are homeless, well, that's really important part of the solution, but working to help people keep from being homeless and prevent them from being homeless, well, that's another big part of the solution. So there are so many parts, and that's, I mean, the name came from a sense of humility that we can do our bit, but there are a lot of things that have to be done.
That we can't be part of the problem, but part of the solution. And there are ways today in terms of dealing with systemic change, making a difference on how through advocacy and presence and dealing with political personalities. They are pieces, and I know you do that because I know you have spoken to the Bronx councils. I know you have been looking at areas throughout the city where your name is there, working to make a difference besides what you do here at POTS.
So if there's no other questions, I don't know if you have any closing thoughts, but I would just say again that this was phenomenal. Really appreciate, I think from my perspective, I really appreciate that you two, Ned, and a lot, as you mentioned, a lot of other people who really contribute along the way to making this ideal a reality. And I think we all have an incredible opportunity to live it out in a daily basis. And I think we're all really quite fortunate to be able to do that. So thank you, guys.
And I want to say my closing remarks are, as much as you say nice things to us about what we did in the foundation, you have no idea what it does to my heart to know that the beginnings have been carried out in the manner in which you're carrying them. So that means a great deal. I wish you didn't have to work in this place. I wish POTS truly was not needed. But while it is, I'm really glad you're here doing it.
Yeah, I would echo what Jane said. We are both very proud of it. We did our bit, and so many people keep carrying it on and making it bigger and better and providing what is this, it's one of these gratifying things that, you know, no matter what I feel like about myself, you know, sometimes I'll do something and I'll think of myself as an ass. No matter how, you know, I've always got this to fall back on, is that we started something that you guys are still doing, and it makes me feel really good to know what you guys are doing. One quick thing I want to mention, because there's one person who I kind of think of as a founder, just because of the spirit she brought to the place, but there was a woman from Hawaii named Nan Hackett, and I just like to mention her name when I can, because when we opened 2763, she came in and she ran the soup kitchen, and she greeted everybody that walked in that door with the phrase, "My friend. Hello, my friend. How can I have my..." And that spirit of seeing everybody as a person, no matter what they look like, and no matter how they behave, because, you know, you guys might have experiences, you know, poor people don't always behave really well. And so sometimes it can be frustrating, but every person that walked in that door was greeted with, "Hello, my friend, welcome." And I think that spirit is the kind that we have to always keep in mind, and especially when it's most difficult. And so I just wanted to mention that and leave you with that. It is how you treat each person that walks in here.